position of ideas that have emerged over the course of like months and months of Zoom calls between a group and then also four people who have sort of prepared this paper, Ana Maria, myself, Felipe Castelblanco, who I always say Castelbianco, and Sebastian Matias. The project, how do we go next? The project kind of joins these two unlikely spaces. What we're trying to do is think about globalist narratives, a concept I'll talk about in a minute called planetary intimacy, and how media and specifically like immersive media forms, 360-degree cameras and things like Insta 360s are kind of informing the kind of work that we all do, which is effectively ethnographic and anthropological visual art practice, just to say one large phrase, yeah.
El trabajo empezó realmente juntando gente de Basel, de la Universidad de Basel, de Berlín, junto con artistas colombianos como Alejandro Duque, Felipe Castelblanco, y como la parte etnográfica y de prácticas artísticas por parte pues, de la Facultad de Artes conmigo, pensando en estos flujos globales y desde un concepto que se llama intimidad planetaria, que ahorita vamos a hablar un poquito más de eso.
Maybe the next slide then. Sí. So this is the whole crew. We've even gathered some people over the last few weeks. I've actually been in Medellin for 2 weeks now. Ana Maria, Felipe, Sebastian, and Jamie, the first four that I mentioned already. Martin Savransky, who does a lot of work around globalist cultural studies, I would say, and critical globalism. He wrote an amazing book called Around the Day in 80 Worlds, which is a great title. Alejo Duque, who some of you might know, who's in Bogota these days at the Planetarium. Sarah Melissa Gallego Quiros, which I don't say correctly, who's an artist and designer and works at AFIT. David Romero, who does a lot of work these days around, too close or too far?
Oh, here, close here.
Oh, that's the thing. This is for the recording.
See.
I'm sorry. I had them mixed up. I'm sorry. Yeah, this doesn't matter quite as much. Okay, this is better. Sorry. I can whisper. David Romero, who's a photographer who does a lot of work in VR these days, also kind of ethnographic style work, and Rafael Blatt, who's our newly hired designer. For the last 2 weeks, we've been doing this kind of large workshop. It's been both a kind of group fieldwork activity, an experiment in using these 360 cameras, which we're sort of interested in, as an immersive form intervening in locales and environments. We've done everything. I arrived in Bogota, and then we drove from Bogota to the Rio Claro area, and we looked around specifically, and we probably won't go into this too much today, but the cement factory that's kind of the Argos cement factory, the Rio Claro area is a big quarry area in Colombia. And the reason that's interesting is because these planetary stories that we're interested in, we're trying to figure out ways of, you know, combining this feeling that we all have that we're interconnected with actual material and physical experiences. And one of the ways that that happens is actually commodity culture, right? The way that you and I both have the same IKEA cup at home is actually a strange form of like personal intimacy, you might say.
Hay una de las cosas que empezaron a, pues que intentamos conectar porque estábamos en Suiza y en Colombia, es cómo, qué tipo de relación tienen estos dos países. Y una de las, economía política, una de las relaciones más claras, ¿cierto? Es precisamente los flujos de capital, los flujos extractivos y el flujo de las cementeras suizas o las mineras suizas que vienen y tienen las empresas acá. Entonces esto fue como una excusa para tener un tema en común, desde la materialidad, para pensarnos estos ejercicios. Entonces, por eso, pues ellos, los dos investigadores que vinieron, Jamie y Sebastian, con el grupo de acá de Colombia, estuvimos haciendo visitas a cementeras, conociendo los flujos, pero también entendiendo el paisaje construido en Medellín desde la mirada del cemento. Pero la pregunta no es por el cemento, es más bien una excusa para encontrar puntos en común en este flujo y en esta conversación Suiza-Colombia.
Thank you. So I guess the project overall is trying to look at globalist and Anthropocene concerns allied with notions of the planetary as defined or sketched by people like Gayatri Spivak. I can never say her name correctly. What is it like to live on a planet that's like this planet? What is it? What is our common experience? Body practices and dance studies, so there's people coming from that area who are interested in movement and corporeal practices. I always summarize this quickly by talking about the way that we move cameras with, you know, gestures and things like that, but it's obviously more complicated than that. And then these 360 cameras, which are sort of this large-scale media intervention into what it is to have a perspective in a recorded environment.
Hay una cosa interesante, y es precisamente este concepto de intimidad, y Spivak, Gayatri Spivak, tiene esta idea de la intimidad crítica, ¿cierto? Entonces, empezando a pensar en qué significa tener una intimidad planetaria a través de estos dispositivos mediáticos, pero nunca perdiendo, pues, como la idea del espectador implicado, o del observador implicado, más bien, que nos proponen los estudios de la danza y los estudios del movimiento. Porque con la tecnología de las cámaras 360, pues siempre está el cuerpo ahí implicado. Entonces fue un experimento interesante en ese sentido. Y pensando mucho precisamente en estos diálogos, las políticas norte-sur, ¿cierto? La economía política y todos estos otros aspectos de los que nunca nos podemos aislar.
I have a feeling you're presenting ahead of what
sí,
I said.
Sí,
it's okay though, it's great. We can do it twice. Economies and intimacies of otherwise is one of the things we wanted to talk about today, which is just to look at the kind of inspiring backgrounds to the project. Then to talk a little bit about the notion of extractivist media, which is of course very, very problematic in people like me showing up in places like this. Principles of participative creative practice, which is a little bit of a romp through. There's a really wonderful paper and a set of literature that talks about the way that Latin American cultures have actually been very much the seat of a kind of media studies and media practice that evolves through community and collaborative practices, which I'm very inspired by. A little bit of an example from Ana Maria, but a prior project. And then we'll just talk about the next steps of our project. So it's a little bit like a project report, because we'd like to involve more people, and I'd love to have your advice and input if you have any. So I might read a little bit just to not lose my place. We have come to a shared diagnosis that there are real powers attempting to keep somewhat faltering modern systems in place, just as they show their cracks and weaknesses. We know that the development logics and ideologies of 20th century and pre-pandemic 21st century can no longer hold, and it is apparent that art, creativity, and media making must understand and change alongside these necessary shifts. It seems that we are perhaps finally exiting the condition of capitalist realism diagnosed by Mark Fisher in the late 2000s, which he understood as a widespread sense that not only is capitalism the only viable political and economic system, but also that there are actually no existent alternatives to it. Such impoverished imaginaries create internal and external oppressions, inabilities to tell other stories, or to learn together outside of the banking model of education, as Paulo Freire called it. This model, Freire famously linked to imposed and self-oppressions, which results in Freire's other well-known diagnosis, which we heard about just a couple minutes ago, cultures of silence, derived from his experiences and exile from Brazil. In our current moment, cultures of silence have become cultures of hyper-mediated social relations that are always on and continuously broadcasting to everyone all the time. In Freire's cultures of silence, particular manifestations of exploitation, marginalization, powerlessness, cultural imperialism, and violence install negative self-images that impede people's abilities to express themselves and gives the illusion that certain people's voices matter more than others. We seem now to be inundated, even compelled to express ourselves in digital media spheres, often the very sources now of exploitation, marginalization, powerlessness, and cultural imperialism. So the idea here is that somehow the culture of silence seems to have inverted itself into a culture of voices. As the French author André Gide has said, everything that needs to be said has already been said, but since no one was listening, everything must be said again. Imaginative reconfigurations of these economized relations that inspire the work we're doing include people like J.K. Gibson Graham, who has an incredible sort of reconfiguration of economies and tries to use positive examples of people who are not, you know, underneath capitalist realism. Arturo Escobar and the Pluriverse, who counter defeatist narratives through examples of praxis that have cut through the apparent realism of financialization and oppression. J.K. Gibson Graham and Gerda Rolvink write that we must be open to what can be learned from current events and to recognize our role in bringing new realities into being, a responsibility we take on as well as experimental researchers. As these mass systems of media undergo massive change, they splinter and represent new local global configurations, and we have also to work on this idea of intimacy and how these relations take place. So I'll just skip ahead because someone just put a lollipop in the air. Maybe the next slide quickly. So there's some dichotomies in all this, right? And they're the standard sort of media studies conflicts in some sense, but they're also really exacerbated post-pandemic, post, you know, an unfortunate and unjust war that's going on in Europe, post the rise of a certain sort of right-wing isolationism and discourses. And they have to do with a lot of this seems like a media study of geopolitics, right? So the increased connectivity that we have also increases passivity. And anybody who's taught a Zoom class knows what I'm talking about. We can talk to everybody, but everyone's really, really passive. Promotion of expression, like let's all talk, but also there's a lot of shame for people who don't feel like they can. And maybe there's the Zoom call, you know, people don't want to show their backgrounds because they're in poverty, or interesting sort of dimensions of transparency and the enforcement of transparency. Exacerbation of networks, so there's more and more networks, but there's also a lot of marginalized people who are not either in those networks or only in specific ones. Okay. Yeah.
Solo quería intervenir para contarles que todas estas discusiones fueron las que vinimos dando pues en los últimos más o menos que 6 meses de trabajo virtual, ¿cierto? Pensando en estas posibilidades de la planetary intimacy y las complicaciones, digamos, que esto ha traído en estas condiciones históricas en las que vivimos.
And the others I will skip, but you get the idea. So just a quick quote from New Models I.O., which is a lecture that was given in Berlin a few days ago. When it comes, because one of the repercussions of all this, of course, is that the ecological and the environmental are completely forgotten. When it comes to our earthbound reality, the public sphere, informed by legacy media, has been hollowed out, and the illusion of a commons we are now left with is that of a cloud state where nobody lives. And so this is what's inspiring a lot of the background of the project, because what we're really interested in, or at least I am, is planetary intimacy. And nobody really knows what this means. I made an attempt at writing what this might mean a few months ago in a publication by the Haus der Kultur und der Welt in Berlin. But it's this idea that somehow care and intimacy can no longer be exclusively figured at an intimate scale. It has to be kind of expanded to relations when it concerns life and livability for the 7 billion people on the planet. I'm quoting Patricia Reed when I say, not to mention the necessary expansion of care to allow for non-humans and the biospheric conditions that support embedded life. And so, yeah.
Y hay una cosa muy interesante que trajo, digamos, la pandemia, la cuarentena, y esa idea de que las cámaras entraran a nuestros espacios privados e íntimos. Y es que trajo a la escena los espacios del cuidado y la importancia de los sistemas del cuidado, ¿cierto? Entonces, aquí cuando Patricia Reed está hablando de esta planetary intimacy, pues en esta definición, lo que estamos hablando es precisamente que estos espacios del cuidado, estos sistemas del cuidado se expanden, no solamente a los sistemas humanos, pero también a los sistemas no humanos y las conexiones entre ellos.
Okay. I might skip the video.
Okay.
It's probably two. We had a video, but it's...
Tenemos un video. Ah, no, este sí, the other one.
Not this. You want to play this one?
I don't know. Este es un video muy lindo de una entrevista de Denise Ferreira da Silva, una teórica brasilera que trabaja en California, con Horton Spillers, y están hablando precisamente de la intimidad. Solo tradujimos esta pequeña cita, pero es precisamente, y aquí hay otro concepto interesante que entra en este concepto de la intimidad crítica, y es el asunto del no daño, de pensar en tener cuidado con los otros, ¿cierto? ¿Sí? de las políticas del cuidado.
Is there some special...
What? Is that one?
Oh, does that play over there now?
Oh, it opens in another window.
Yeah.
Sorry. We can play it, why not?
We might go a little over time. So I think we're going to skip a little bit past this. This is just a dialogue about the fact that, you know, when we're working as artists, we're implicated in global systems of distribution. And obviously, we're all trying to avoid these problems of por no misera and things like this.
Esta parte era un poco para hablar casi como una postura que se conversó mucho en la investigación sobre las ideas de los medios extractivistas o de la forma de producir media de una manera extractivista, precisamente por los flujos que teníamos entre Suiza y Colombia. Era muy importante como tener eso muy claro y entender esta forma de producción de medias y de las industrias culturales a la par como otras industrias como la producción de cobre o cualquier otra cosa, pues como una industria que funciona con unas lógicas internas específicas. Right?
And I think, just to summarize it, like one of the things that we're interested in terms of media archaeological or media historical trajectories is between this, which of course is a standard sort of filmic perspective, the notion of a kind of implicated subject, which Anna Maria mentioned earlier, and, you know, this kind of final step of sorts, which is, for us anyway, for the moment, which is this notion of a kind of 360 camera. And there are lots of great examples. Because of the technicality here, I don't know if I'll show this, but if you have a chance, please check out Studio Crashers, which is, it's really interesting because it's an interview format that could be a standard ethnographic, you know, kind of moment. It's basically a person talking to another person. But because of the way he does it, the person who's doing the interview, is he brings a 360 camera and puts it in the center of this discussion, and then does a kind of full 360 grab at the same time as having a normal camera pointing at the person. And so what you see on the left there is actually a 3D, he's kind of re-rendered the normal scene into the. Oh. I think it's going to take too long to do all that. It's okay. If we could just click on it, we would show it, but you can see it later. So it's an interesting thing because basically what you see is the interviewer, the way that he's positioned himself, the way he's sitting, is he interested, is he not interested? And all of that is part of this kind of reconfiguration of the standard gaze of the anthropological or ethnographic filmmaker. So quickly to reference a few things that have inspired the specific sort of South American collaboration. I know we're over time, I'm sorry, we'll go quick. This is just a really great paper, I'll just say that for now. It's the Rediscovering the Latin American Roots of Participatory Communication for Social Change, where Alejandro Barranquero does a really great job of kind of pulling apart the ways that like the hegemonic North American and European media studies and media practice has disappeared the sort of grassroots and DIY practices and praxis-based sort of theorizing of South American media collectives. And these are the examples he gives and some of the stuff that have inspired us as well.
Sí, esto eran como unas referencias que estuvimos mirando precisamente para partir desde las prácticas ya existentes en Latinoamérica, precisamente pensando en la potencia de pensar desde la práctica misma y elaborar desde ahí. Entonces, aquí hay como una pregunta de que también tiene la investigación y es buscar otros grupos que están pensando estas mismas conexiones transnacionales artísticos, de comunicación, que estén pensando estas mismas cosas globalistas, y es como una pregunta pues, para la gente, para ustedes que están más en el mundo de los medios. Esta parte es un ejemplo de trabajo colaborativo y precisamente aquí queremos problematizar la pregunta de cuando uno está trabajando con otra gente, si uno, cuál es la diferencia entre colaborar, participar o co-crear, ¿cierto? Y cómo, de qué manera las prácticas artísticas que nos aterrizan a formas muy corporales problematizan las formas de creación colectiva, ¿cierto? Y las dinámicas de poder y las dinámicas de quién tiene y no tiene voz, quién tiene y no tiene capacidad de decisión y como todas estas pequeñas preguntas éticas y políticas que no se pueden nunca escapar. Este es el ejemplo pues, que de un trabajo que acaba de terminar con un grupo de investigación que se llama corpografías.com, pero no lo vamos a presentar. Y para terminar, entonces, es básicamente contarles que ahí estamos. O sea, que estamos en esto es como decía Jamie, casi que un avance de los primeros pasos de una investigación que ha sido muy interesante en términos de que no sigue las lógicas de las investigaciones minciencias tradicionales que te obligan a tener resultados claros y procesos, sino que estamos dejando más bien guiarnos por los encuentros y hacia dónde van girando nuestras intereses. Entonces, contarles que aquí estamos y que pues miren intentando poner en diálogo como todas estas perspectivas entre el movimiento, la corporalidad, la producción de media desde el productor o la productora implicada, el cuerpo que está implicado en la producción con unas miradas éticas y políticas que quieren complicar las relaciones y los flujos de capital y de conocimiento. Muchas gracias. Gracias.